please let me give you a warm welcome from the city of Frankfurt. My name is Shane Bushka. I am an attorney for U.S. law at Randolph Obermueller Partner, and I will be your host for the next 2 days, along with my colleague, Arnaldo Garon. Together we will guide you through the proceedings of the next 2 days, which will take place concurrently in this room, as well as in the two rooms opposite to us across the hall. Over the course of these proceedings, we will learn about the past, the present, and most importantly, the future of legal technology on the market. How we can learn to become more efficient as attorneys and as businessmen and women. Now, without further ado, it is my great pleasure to introduce you to Dr. Joachim Brandhoff. He is the founder and CEO of Legal Revolution, and will officially open our ceremony today.
Mr. Lord, honored dignitaries, ladies and gentlemen, good morning and welcome. I'm Joachim Brandhoff. The automation of law presents us with challenges. We will only be able to face them if we are able to expand our knowledge of the digital technologies. For some of us, this will mean fundamentally changing, revolutionizing their technical understanding. Over the course of the next 2 days, I ask you to help us jumpstart this process. Part of this will involve exchanging ideas with your peers. But above all, this means learning from experts in other fields, computer scientists, IT professionals, project managers, businessmen and women. Is this working? This is not working. Is this working? Yeah! Let's start the legal revolution. That's a remarkable resource waiting to be tapped simply by solidifying relationships between legal professionals and technical experts. Lawyers will only continue to be successful if they open their worlds to other experts for the sake of greater efficiency, profitability, and even for the sake of economic survival. I do not want to delve too deeply into the digital transformation, because we have so many great speakers and exhibitors waiting to share their knowledge with you. But I think it's important to mention one thing, much too often.
And now down again. Is it working or not?
I am sorry. Much too often, I hear people, even experts, say lawyers should embrace the new technology. But in the same breath, they say we should not be too fearful. Legal technology will not replace us. This is misleading. Nobody will believe that the advancement of artificial intelligence will not, unfortunately, at least eliminate some legal jobs. In the long run, only those lawyers who will be able to educate themselves, to adapt to the new markets, who will allow their business models and their processes to be constantly tested and improved, will be able to not just survive, but even to profit from digitization. It is therefore my hope that we can look at the digitization with an optimistic spirit, that we can boldly explore the opportunities provided by the legal tech opportunities, that we can develop a convincing ethical framework and legal rules for governing the new technologies, and that, like that, we can ultimately maximize the positive aspects while mitigating the negative. Before we begin, I would like to express my thanks to everyone involved in making this endeavor possible. I am very thankful to be in the presence of such a great group of delegates, speakers, exhibitors, and of course, the Legal Revolution team. Nicola Baer, unfortunately, couldn't make it because she had to go to Jamaica for a meeting of her parliamentary group, but Kalle Palin was kind enough to fly in. The well-known Estonian parliamentarian was kind enough to fly in one day earlier. Thanks so much, Kalle. 20 members of the Legal Revolution team will be your hosts in the next 2 days. Please, let any of us know if there's anything you need. In the spirit of the Legal Revolution, I would like to invite you in the next 2 days to take a look around and find the best digital solution for your firm or your company. For the investors among you, I have a message. The legal innovations industry is ripe for investments. There are also great opportunities for cooperation among legal tech companies. For example, between the innovative developer and the larger provider with established distribution channels. Today, you all find yourselves in the same room. Take this opportunity. Now is the time. Let's get started.
Thank you very much, Joachim. Looks like we're going to need a communications revolution now. As Dr. Bonoff noted, lawyers will increasingly become more dependent on technical experts to complete their tasks. Now, this is not to say that the role of lawyers will become less important in the future. On the contrary, making legal decisions will become much more difficult as the amount of information and misinformation increases in legal cases and commercial dealings. At the moment, legal systems around the world are being challenged by an unprecedented and overwhelming amount of information being brought before them. How do we solve this problem? When will we make this transition? And who will own the legal future? These are all very big questions that we hope to answer over the course of the next 2 days. I would like to now invite Professor Alexander Lorz to the stage to answer this last question. Who will own the legal future? Professor Lorz teaches public law and international law at the University of Düsseldorf, and he is the Minister of Education for the German state of Hessen. Mr. Lorz.
First thing I have to ask for is technical assistance, of course. To this microphone, I guess. So now, ladies and gentlemen, wasn't that a great example of the limits of technology this morning? And I just talked to Dr. Remmers, who will speak right after me, I think. He said, well, you know, you experience it all day long. You come to a congress, the presentation doesn't work, the microphone doesn't work. It reminds me of the mechanics dealing with my car, who also check it out, you know, with all kind of modern legal stuff, laptop, etc. And finally say, well, it's better to have a screwdriver in my pocket as well. I think, although this was, of course, not planned, assure you, it wasn't planned. But I think it's a nice illustration of the balancing act we have to perform when it comes to how to employ modern technology, how to use it, in our case, for making legal services better, more efficient, more cost-effective, and so on. At the same time, of course, not basically handing everything over to technology alone. So my claim is, and there we have my basic thesis right at the very beginning, that there is still a very important, perhaps the pivotal place for us as human beings and as lawyers, even within the framework of new technology. And let's try to explore that a bit more in detail. But first of all, of course, I would also like to extend a very warm welcome to all of you. I'm right here in the city of Frankfurt as a member of the state government of Hessen. We are very proud of Frankfurt being, among other things, a legal hub, a really international legal hub. And so, of course, will also be a hub for everything that takes place within the framework of what you can call modernization of legal services. I think Frankfurt is really a hot place to be. And so I'm happy, greetings to all of you who are not from here, that you have come here despite the traffic jams. Traffic jams happen despite all modern technology. And it is my pleasure to give the introduction to this very interesting conference. If you have or if you look at the scenario that basically underlies the topic of this conference, then, if I may make the association to my civil profession as a professor of law, as well as to my official function as being the Minister or Secretary of Public Education here in Hessen, of course, education is the key, will be the key to everything within this new world. Now that's kind of a platitude today, because everyone says it, education, most important thing of everything, and so on and so forth. Of course, as the competent minister, you're happy to hear that, especially if it leads to more money being channeled into the field of public education, which we right now do. To a very large extent. Not everything that is going into automatization or into the digital transformation of education, but at least part of our efforts also concerns the digital transformation of education. And of course, there are lots of... What have I done now? What was my mistake? If you look at the challenges of the future, from the viewpoint of education, be it general education at school or be it legal education, then of course these challenges appear in different fashions. Especially within the public schools, of course, we have the challenge of providing the necessary IT equipment. You might have read that the still Minister of Education and Research for the Federal Republic of Germany, Johanna Banka, has announced a digital compact for the future, 5 billion euros to be invested in IT equipment and educational institutions. And now we are waiting and hoping for the new federal government. Therefore, of course, I also excuse Nicola Beer. My former boss at the Minister of Public Education, she's currently negotiating Jamaica, and I'm very hopeful, because basically everyone has confessed to this goal, that we will come up with a massive project of investing in IT equipment in public schools and beyond. Now, in legal education, of course, in legal services, well, IT equipment is, of course, something to care about, but I think it's not really the hurdle for implementing new technology in legal services. And it is much more interesting to teach the teachers, so to make sure that those people who teach, be it at our public schools or be it at our public universities, that they also adapt to this new world, and that they prepare the young students For this new world, of course, young students who are probably much more deeply into modern technology than their teachers, but nevertheless teachers, because of their specific experience, and of course because of their specific education, might have, should have, the abilities to work together with the students on how to employ new technology and how to make good use of it. And then of course you will employ digital media in all kinds of teaching, be it at school, be it at the university, where we had, for instance, things like these MOOCs, the massive open online courses, and there will be many more tools who are already under construction or already developed right now. So I'm quite sure that the field of education, especially the field of legal education, will also change, has to change, in order to adjust to these new challenges. So what are these new challenges? If we look at the overarching trends in the legal industry, I think we have two different tendencies, two different trends who will shape the legal industry in the future, and so therefore legal education will have to react to these trends. We have, on the one hand, of course, the scale of automated legal work rising. That is basically what we're talking about for the 2 days to come. That is basically what all the exhibitions out there are about. We have many more possibilities than in earlier times within the digital transformation to make legal work just happen through technology. So that's the trend on the one hand. And on the other hand, and these trends were kind of independent of each other, but now they are somehow intertwined. They are about to merge to one kind of mega trend that the walls around the legal profession are currently torn up. And that is true for in many respects. What is called in German the Rechtsberatungsgesetz, the law on legal counseling, that at least all the German lawyers here are very familiar with, that has been loosened in many respects over the past years already. Now, of course, we have European law, European common market law, free movement of workers, freedom of establishment, the mutual recognition of diplomas and qualifications, and all that contributes to the fact that there are not only lawyers with a second state examination in law who will in the future render legal services of some kind within Germany. And the same is true for other countries within the European Union, for sure. But I also think all over the world that many more people will enter the legal profession through back doors or through side doors without having taken, you know, full legal education that is kind of, that is somehow incorporated in Germany in the second state examination. And they will be able to, they will be able to participate in the rendering of legal services because of the digital transformation. And some of these people might be better, especially in terms of service orientation, but perhaps also in, terms of distribution of work, of acquisition of clients, than lawyers usually are. And this is something I have to take on as a professor of law myself. Acquisition of clients, distribution of legal services, these are not really the things we teach at a German law school, a typical German university. Perhaps we have, or for sure we have to change for the future. But nevertheless, I think it will not completely it will not completely eradicate this new trend that competition will become harder, and there will be many more people on the legal market within the legal service industry to compete with. And so, if more people are enabled to render legal advice, which will also have the advantage that access to justice will be facilitated to a lot of people, and then that of course means that adaptation will be necessary. And how is this adaptation, or what are the fields within which this this adaptation is supposed to happen. This is just a small selection, perhaps an almost random selection of the things that might happen, of the fields of application that are concerned. And all the following speakers, I'm quite sure, will elaborate on these various areas in detail. But if you look at that, I've put document management, data analysis, for instance, within the framework of due diligence examinations in the center, because I think that is the field where technology might, within the foreseeable future, bring most of a revolution about, which will also put in question perhaps the biggest number of workplaces within the legal industry. For if you have kind of automated libraries, if you have data analysis that is performed by machines without, you know, having human beings to or without human beings necessarily looking at every single document in these mega files of complex cases, but if computers pre-select the legal issues, help lawyers identify the issues, and basically only the contentious issues, the issues that really ask for legal argumentation in depth, are presented to the human beings, to the lawyers working on the case, then that will of course save a lot of work, a lot of time, a lot of costs, but might also spare a lot of workplaces that currently exist in the legal industry. I could also name things like client intake, like preparing the necessary boilerplate documents for rendering legal services. I just read a couple of weeks ago that my former alma mater, Harvard Law School, where I studied in the 90s, is now employing legal technology for its legal clinics, just to make sure that the students who work in these legal clinics, that they don't have to care about, you know, how to prepare the file. This is all done in an automated way. So basically, all the client information is fed into the system, and then the students and the law professors basically get a file that is ready to be worked upon from the legal viewpoint. You will hear presentations on things like personal profiling. That may be true, for instance, for staffing legal offices, so for recruiting lawyers and legal staff. But it also may draw a comparison to a field I've been working in while I was still in the legal business. And when you talk about an industry like arbitration, the hallmark of arbitration is usually that the parties of the case get to pick their own arbitrators for the panel. And so the question, of course, is whom are you going to pick as an arbitrator? And it will be very interesting to have as much information as possible about how this person might think, what is the general disposition of the person in question. And of course, this is already done today by researching on the internet and basically looking up everything that is available in terms of information about this person. But if you can employ automated research programs for that task, it will certainly make things even more interesting at that point. And advertising, of course, acquiring clients, more and more legal services will be distributed by the internet. People will not even come to you as lawyers, unless, of course, you have an appearance, that is also external appearance presentation, on the internet that attracts them. And of course, it is also important for information exchange and networking in the broadest sense, and I think today's event is a wonderful example for that. I see this is also a wonderful example for technology. He is putting up a sign that I have 2 minutes left, so let's move on a little bit. I think the question is, who keeps the final say? And I'm quite sure, or as I put it here, to balance technical progress and acceptance by society. I'm quite sure that, of course, legal technology will make a lot of tasks easier when it comes to standardization of contracts, for instance. But even in judging individual cases or even the making of laws. However, and that is my thesis, my conviction, that especially when it comes to making these individual judgments or to develop, to draft the norms that shape our life in legal society or our life as a society, that perhaps the final say should be left to human beings, because otherwise we will get a problem with the acceptance by society. So while we'll have the algorithms that help us identify the issues on which we have to decide, but whether they will really make the decision at the end, that for me is an open question. And if I make a perhaps a slightly slippery association, if we talk about things like internet dating, never done this myself, so I'm like a blind person talking off colors. If you look at these platforms like Parship, whatever, they of course make a pre-selection. They present you, you know, with persons you might want to get to know, to fall in love with, whatever. But I think the ultimate decision with whom you fall, that's a decision you would like to make yourself, aren't you? And of course, by looking into the eyes of this person, and talking to this person, not just by exchanging data via the internet. I think things are a little bit similar in the legal industry. And so, like in any other cases, artificial intelligence is maybe a benefit or a hazard. Just going back to general education for a moment. I'm quite sure we're talking a lot about digital transformation of our schools, and rightly so. And nevertheless, I'm quite convinced that our children will still have to learn how to read, to write, and to calculate. Because without these basic cultural techniques, they will not be able to handle the internet. And my claim is that this is also true for our business, for the legal industry, and therefore my motto is always look at the bright side of life. The art of legal argumentation, my thesis, cannot be fully replaced by technology. It all revolves around interests, taking stock of them, assessing them, weighing them, balancing them. And I think the more you move from taking stock through balancing, as the arrows shall indicate, the less important the role of technology becomes. That is to say, taking stock of interests, assessing interests, or basically collecting the material, that is certainly a job for modern technology. That is certainly a job for for digital transformation and for putting more tools into the legal industry. But when it comes to placing the necessary weight on the certain interests, when it comes to the final act of balancing, I think there is still a long way to be gone before human beings and their legal minds can fully be replaced by technology, if ever. And that is a hopeful sign, and I would like to conclude on this note. Better keep the final say. Thank you very much for listening.
Presents us with a wonderful segue, in fact. I'd like to ask you all now a question. Within the framework of Professor Lourdes' thesis, how will we as lawyers and businessmen and women interact with technology in the future? What will the interface be? How will we use it in our daily lives to get our tasks completed? Please help me now welcome Professor Thomas Remus onto the stage. He is the president of the German Bar Association, an expert in corporate and public law. Dr. Rivers.
Good morning, everybody. That's worse. We heard a lot. Thank you very much for the Lord for so many input just in the beginning with all the wide fields we have heard. But to cover all the aspects of legal tech, the challenge for the juridical professions is the challenge itself. Legal tech covers a wide range of different fields of use. Not all of them pose a real problem for the legal professions, and the challenge will take place in the market, not within regulations. Today, lawyers can provide legal advice analog and not digital, but a lot of lawyers mostly use digitalization and means as a means of support for their daily actual work. Indeed, this kind of technology changes the activities of the lawyer. However, it does not change the lawyer's intellectual work, not even nowadays. It seems to be just a question of time that artificial intelligence will be able to replace parts of lawyers' intellectual work. This brings us to the next subject, namely the lawyer and technology. Legal advice in digitalization, the changing market, and the fear of so-called disruption. These issues do not only exist within the framework of the development and operation of the BR, but these are also dealt with intensively by us, the German Federal Bar. The effect of digitalization on the legal market are clearly visible and tangible. The new legal startups, many of them are represented here today, show us that legal advice must also take place digitally. There is not only the demand for it, but also the necessity. Today's consumers, and thus also the client, expect digital consulting. But why? Because nowadays, you can do almost everything online. So why not solving legal problems online? This development has also led to the fact that today the market segment is being catered for, which did not exist for the legal profession before, namely minor claims. Who would go to a lawyer for a claim of about 70, 100 or 300 euro, knowing that even the first consultation of a lawyer will probably cause fees which are higher than even the claim? The new internet platforms offer consumers the opportunity to obtain almost basic legal advice for a low price condition. Another kind of software makes it possible to evaluate big data in seconds and to draw conclusions using if-then relationships. A large proportion of these clients would have refrained from pursuing their claims without these platforms, either for reasons of costs, ignorance, or even credibility. But this is only one of many parts of the impact of digitalization. Of course, such platforms also cater for a part of the market which is already served by law firms, and thus they represent competition. One might say that a platform is a kind of specialization, similar to bar-approved specialized lawyers, the German Fachanwalt. When specializations were introduced, the market shift in law firms could be observed from a simple lawyer to being a specialized lawyer. A similar market shift is now taking place between the lawyers and the platforms. But of course, this market shift is the reason why lawyers are concerned. Briefly said, technology has already achieved a stage which can affect the job market of lawyers themselves. Furthermore, they should be worried, not only for financial reasons, as some of you here may think, but also because lawyers hold an important position in our society, in our constitutional state. That is to say, they have an important education and a specific organization of the legal profession. A transition of legal services to non-lawyers would significantly impact our rule of law structures. The core elements of the lawyer's position are, inter alia, independence and professional secrecy. Only these core elements ensure that lawyers are able to fulfill their duties in a state governed by the rule of law, on an equal footing with other organs of the administration of justice. On the one hand, independence from the state, as well as freedom from government and other directives, enable a lawyer to provide legal advice that is controlled only by the interests of the client. On the other hand, the institute of the obligation of secrecy does not serve the interests of the lawyer, as it is often asserted by many of them, but protects the client and the enforcement of the client's rights. Without these core values, the client's interest cannot be properly represented, neither against private third parties, nor against authorities, courts, or other governmental organizations. And this is also stated in the Legal Service Code, the RDG, which determines whether one can or cannot provide legal services. According to the code, the RDG is designed to protect those who seek justice in order to ensure legal transactions and the legal system against unqualified legal services. Thus, to provide such a service, legal experience is particularly required, but this alone can explain the protective scope of the RDG. The RDG also affects those persons who have the necessary qualifications, but are neither admitted as lawyers nor work as authorized legal service providers. The reason why only the lawyer can be the independent advisor and representative in all legal matters is that the lawyer is an independent organ of the administration of justice and with all the rights and obligations associated with this important task. This might raise the question whether a platform can have rights and obligations and guarantee them very unlikely. As you probably have noticed, this is an excellent topic to discuss and argue about, and this is what the German Federal Bar is currently doing. Besides the platforms in the legal tech area, there are also a lot of software tools which make the lawyer's work easier and completely change the way in which they work. For example, voice recognition software eliminates the need for type and dictating. Electronic file management makes filing less complicated, and the cloud allows you to create a virtual office that the client can access at any time from his home and learn about the progress of his or her case. Thus, law firms are put in a position where they can do more work with considerably less staff. Consequently, law firms remain competitive. However, I would claim that only those who use all these innovations will survive in this changing market. Lawyers who join the trend of digitalization have a better chance to assert their position on the market. But this applies to all markets with the theme of digitalization. Finally, what does the future hold for us? The Watsons, Rosses, and Co. of this world will be further developed, and so will the law. Nobody knows what the final outcome of all of this will be. Will lawyers be completely replaced by machines? The end of lawyers? Will the enforcement of rights and most of the judges be replaced by online arbitration? We will not be able to answer these and many other questions today, but we can contribute and discuss. All lawyers should make sure that our system of social justice is maintained, and then digitalization will be a normal part of this development in a changing society. The German Federal Bar accepts this challenge, and if changes become necessary, especially in the area of the rules of our professional law, we will discuss them and help all partners in the legal market maintain or improve their positions in this market. All in all, I'm delighted to be here and see what the market has brought up to today and will develop in the future. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Ramers. Now, for a more governmental perspective, allow me to bring up Mr. Kyle Pollack. Kyle Pollack is a member of parliament of the Digital Role Model State of Estonia. And as Dr. Branoff mentioned earlier, we're very thankful to him for taking time out of his busy schedule to come here, as he has taken time away from a very important and unscheduled parliamentary vote. He would like to speak with you today on smart, the use of smart technology in administrations in his home state, which is a leader in e-governance as well as e-residency and e-citizenship.
Mr. Paul. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. I am delighted and honored to be here today as among lawyers and probably some accountants. I'm giving you the other view of a state as a model where you probably don't need lawyers and accountants so much anymore. But excuse me. So I'm an MP. I've been an MP, elected MP for 11 years. And I'm an advocate for a coolest country in the world, probably. But one thing that I'd like to focus on, and I'm suggesting you as well to focus on during these 2 days, is to how we'll achieve a situation where we have decision makers that actually understand what technology enables us to do. So the biggest challenge in all the governments is that the politicians still don't understand what technology enables us to do. But nevertheless, Estonia is a country that has never had much money, a huge internal market on mineral resources, but we have a lot of enterprising people. According to the World Economic Forum, we have a lot of enterprising, we are the most enterprising country in the EU. Estonians are the pathfinders in the ICT world today, searching for new solutions to get things done cheaper and faster. We are like a village of inventors in a global world because we realize that our small size is a huge advantage that can help create efficient solutions in the world that the world desperately needs. Since Estonia regained its independence in early 90s, the country's GDP has risen some 8 times. Some theorize that a third of that may be due to minimizing transaction costs and inefficiency in the society to ICT solutions and consciously building up the IT literacy and awareness in the society. Do you remember what changed the world's price of international calls? What made free international calls possible? Skype was originally developed and continues to develop in Estonia. International financial transfers using the same philosophy became a reality thanks to TransferWise. Finally, CrabCat became the Facebook of engineers, connecting the creative minds of the world's engineers to make the engineers themselves much more efficient. The private sector is doing well, but what about the public sector? We are probably the only country in the world where the cabinet meetings have no paper trail. Ministers can sign decisions from a smartphone in the backseat of their car using digital signatures and mobile ID. Estonia might be the only country in the world with a governmental startup, the e-residency program. By 2025, this nation, with little over 1 million citizens, aims to provide a world-class business environment and services for 10 million EU residents. We, all of us here, do not need to go to bank to make payments. We all understand that, and this is today's reality. This can be done at home. In fact, very few daily dealings require us to leave homes, submitting tax claims, arranging a doctor appointment, checking what homework our children have, signing contracts, even electing members of the parliament, and much more can be done at home in a minute in Estonia. The weather does not affect the election results at all. We believe in a concept where a client citizen with a digital identity will have a higher standard of living, they pay more taxes and be more productive and creative. The government is there to assist him so that things in his life just work and create an environment for companies for a more seamless way of operating. E-governance is a strategic choice for Estonia that aims to improve the competitiveness of the country and increase the well-being of its people. Our dream is to keep government as small as possible, but also available 24/7. This is supported by the availability of digital identity for every citizen, secure and efficient data exchange, and high-quality databases. Estonians trust these solutions and use them every day. Virtually all state-related operations are completed digitally. Prescriptions, tax returns, claims, or starting a business. Every Estonian saves an average of 5 working days each year thanks to signing documents digitally. It's like getting an extra week vacation every year. The privacy of our citizens is the first priority. They have the right to know who is using data about them. We use the once-only principle so that citizens only have to submit their data once for the government and to use and reuse. The e-government infrastructure is harmonized and provides extensive space for innovation in the public services. After the first steps towards becoming an e-state, we understood that the risk of cyber attacks will always be part of the information society, a risk that must be taken seriously. After analyzing different solutions, Estonia found a solution for this, and it's blockchain technology. Although blockchain has only become hot technology in recent years, Estonia is leading the way in the blockchain revolution. Estonia has been testing the technology since 2008. Since 2012, blockchain has been in use in Estonian data registers, such as the National Health, Judicial, Legislative, Security and Commercial Code systems, with plans to extend its use to other spheres, such as personal medicine, cybersecurity, and data analysis. Thanks to its mathematically verifiable code, which is distributed to millions of computers all over the world, blockchain technology can be seen as digital defense dust. It spreads over data and smart devices in the defense sector in order to detect every sign of the misuse of the data according to changes in the pattern of the dust. In this way, millions of lives and resources are saved, while the potential manipulation of defense data or war machines is prevented. Thanks to its experience, Estonia is today home of the NATO Cooperative Cyber Defense Center of Excellence and the EU IT agency that all use the Estonian KSI blockchain technology to secure their systems. Blockchain technology itself does not secure the data, but works like a speed camera that detects who has violated the law, when and how. To the fact that data protected by blockchain technology is covered with digital defense dust that covers millions of computers all over the world. Every use and misuse of the data can be detected as it leaves a trace in the pattern. Thanks to implementing this technology, the situation that Mr. Snowden caused would never happen in Estonia. In contrast to everywhere else in the world, in Estonia, patients own their personal data, which is secured by blockchain technology. Since 2008, hospitals and doctors in Estonia are required to digitalize data and make it available in the health record. In order to keep health information completely secure, at the same time accessible and authorized individuals, the electronic ID card system uses blockchain technology to ensure data integrity and mitigate internal threats to the data. In this way, every occurrence of data use and misuse is detectable and major damages to a person's health can be prevented. I mentioned e-residency. Estonia is creating a new borderless digital nation for global citizens, powered by the Republic of Estonia, where no one is held back from their entrepreneurial potential. E-residency is a transnational government-issued digital identity that everyone in the world can apply for and then gain access to a platform built on inclusion, legitimacy and transparency. E-residents have access to the EU business environment and can use the public e-services through their digital identity. The primary reason why e-residents join this community, at the moment we have more than 20,000 e-residents from 138 different countries, is to run a trusted, location-independent EU business online with all the tools needed to conduct business globally. With e-residency, you can establish the company within a day. Don't need a lawyer and an accountant, just saying. Apply for a digital business banking account and credit cards, conduct e-banking access, online payment providers like PayPal and so on, and digitally sign documents and contracts and declare taxes all online from anywhere in the world. It's Estonia's gift to the world, the opportunity for everyone anywhere to succeed as an entrepreneur. Why to open a company in Estonia? Because Estonia has one of the most advanced digital societies. There's minimal bureaucracy and fair tax framework. Estonian membership to the EU, NATO, OECD and Eurozone provides advantages and stability. There are low startup and maintenance costs, business is transparent and the level of corruption is really low. Growth is incentivized with 0% corporate tax on reinvested profits and you can trade in euros to mitigate risk of currency fluctuations. In future, it's believed that countries will compete for e-residents based on the quality of their public services and their business environment. Several other countries have already taken the first step to learn from Estonia and introduce similar programs. However, the e-residency program has already incorporated services from partners in a range of different countries and continues to do so. As the community of e-residents grows, so does the entrepreneurial system around them. If you want to be a part of an effective country, where simply by signing digitally you get additional week of vacation, and where you can elect a parliament from comfort of your own home, come to Estonia. If you want to become a part of effective business environment and e-services, become a e-resident of Estonia. Europe is facing a declining population and unsustainable social welfare costs. Government size and efficiency has been and these a constant topic. There is the question of the source of the next economic growth wave. Estonia is working hard to be an attractive business and investment climate. One thing that we are putting into practice is services that find entrepreneurs and citizens at the right time. The old notion is that companies and citizens should understand how government works. What we can learn from the successful private companies, mainly banks, telcos, is that they have made it incredibly easy to consume their services, thereby attracting new and retaining existing customers. This is what a successful government needs to do in the future as well. Make it easy for any new customer, read, investor and entrepreneur, to consume their services, read, invest and start a business. The biggest challenge for any country in the globalizing world in the 21st century is how to get other people to pay for the welfare of your own citizens. How to encourage and entice people from across the globe to come and do their business and pay their taxes to your country. This is where the good governance and smart country infrastructure comes in, creating a seamless society where everything just works. Thank you very much. Welcome to this.
Scott Pally, everybody. Now we move to a more back to the academic front. Dr. Martin Fries, Professor Martin Fries, will now be joining us. He is a professor of international law at the University of Munich, and he poses a simple question: evolution or revolution? Cycles of revolution are defined generally as long periods of calm interspersed by very sharp, violent change. Compare this to the slow, steady processes governed by natural processes that define an evolutionary event. Both certainly present challenges to us and to those who experience them. But which situation do we find ourselves? Mr. Fries perhaps has the answer.
Thank you. Hi, everyone. So thank you for the kind invitation, Shane, and thanks for the opportunity to share my thoughts on the university perspective on legal tech with you. It's actually my last day in Germany, because tomorrow I'm going to be moving to Estonia, I guess. Because everything that I was always hoping for seems to be already present in that nation. Now the last thing we are going to work with is the presentation, because here is the subject I'm talking about. And also I want to take up the issue from where Mr. Lors was leaving it, which is basically, now I have to proceed somewhere, which is kind of difficult. Which is basically online dating. And my question will be from the university perspective, if there's a match between university and the law as we've always taught it, and on the other hand, the technology that we see is kind of revolutionizing the legal world. Now, I'd like to, I'm also not on Tinder, so just in case you want to. I want to follow this question in three steps. The first being having a look at how the jurisprudence, how universities, how law schools look like today. The second step being have a look at legal practice and see whether what we teach at universities still fits what is done in legal practice. And the third step, having a look at how we might shape the study of law for the future. First step, what would you study? If in case you today you started studying law, how would legal technology impact what you learn in at the university? Now, actually, what we teach at universities is basically the law itself, substantive law. In my field, it's civil law. And then the second might be the law of procedure, of civil procedure in my field, which means the way how we enforce laws in front of public courts. And basically, that's it. It is given by the state. They tell what we have to teach, and that's it. So there's little leeway for legal technology, one is tempted to think. If you have a look at what happens at the universities, you first might have a look at the institutions, and you might see there are actually two legal tech centers at German universities, one in Hamburg. The Bucerius Law School is kind of the pioneer in the field of legal tech. And the second one was emerging at the other Frankfurt. So there's not only this Frankfurt in Germany, but the other Frankfurt, which is in the east of Berlin. It's a little like village, but they have a university, and they also have a legal tech center recently founded at a university. But basically, that's it. We have about 50 law schools in Germany, and those two are the only organizations at universities that are solely devoted to legal tech. So that's not so much. And if you have a look at what happens in terms of events, I tried to build a graph that basically shows you what's going on. Throughout the last, or what was going on throughout the last couple of years. You see in 2015, that is basically at zero, no legal tech events whatsoever. And then it slowly starts from 2016. Maybe I was the first one when I had a temporary professorship at the University of Münster in Northern Germany. I did a seminar on legal tech, and to be honest, two people showed up. I mean, that was the start. And as you can see, this has kind of developed throughout the last 12 months. So if you would try to count the legal tech events at university this year, it might already be some like 20 workshops, conferences, and so on. And they, like the graph is showing in the right direction, we might think. However, if you have a look at the number of law students in total, I can only guess that. Maybe 50,000 law students we have in Germany, I don't know. You can go far with 20 events, so that's not much in terms of educating the whole mass of law students. So the question is, what we teach, if what we basically teach is only civil law or the substantive law and then procedural law, whether that is, that is the kind of law that leads young lawyers into the future. And this brings me to my second step, which is legal practice. As every lawyer in this room knows, some would say you can't practice law without knowing the law. At least I know some lawyers who kind of do, but you rather shouldn't do it. So it is important, and it will stay important, no question about that. However, I think in the field of procedural law, as well as in the field of substantive law, there are changes brought in by legal technology that we have to face also at the universities. I give you two examples. First example from the field of procedural law. When we talk about procedural law, we talk about court procedure. And our court procedures are very sophisticated, but they are also very complicated. And if you want to bring change into those procedures, it's very, very difficult. An example, you might have heard about the Volkswagen emissions scandal. So in order to give consumers effective rights or enforcement mechanisms for those rights, politics, maybe even the Jamaica discussions with the parties right at the moment in Berlin, they discuss about something like a class action, what we already know from the United States and what it was implemented in a similar way in other European countries in the last couple of years. There's no real or almost no real class action in Germany so far, and whoever is teaching and doing research on procedural law says it is very, very difficult to make it compatible with our procedural principles. The thing is, while we're still discussing it on the political level, it's already happening in practice due to thanks to legal tech. So this is a screenshot from MyRight.de. which is a company that was founded solely for the purpose of enforcing consumer rights in the Volkswagen emission scandal. So they take up consumer claims or consumer cases. I think they have already some 50,000 collect them, and then they bundle them and bring them to court. So they had a first kind of class action. It's an anti-competitive way of class action that they brought to court in September, and then move on with the second of such a claim next year. If you want to get more information about that, we had a conference at the University of Mannheim in early September. If you go on YouTube and you just search for Legal Tech Mannheim, you will find a 30-minute presentation with the founder of MyRight. It's highly interesting because he tells you that he doesn't care, not at all, but the principles of procedural law is not the first thing he cares about. What he cares about is his client, is the consumer. So this is a completely different perspective. And while politics are still discussing, they're simply doing it. And I think if we talk about the law of the future, we should make something like a legal technology check and check what is technically possible, and also see which of our principles are maybe too complicated and might be kind of overtaken by legal technology. And even though they exist, they might not be in real practice. The second example, aside from procedural law, is the substantive law. So we tend to think that substantive law is something that legal technology cannot touch, because substantive law, like procedural law, is made by the legislator, and private companies and business angels, they can't make laws. So they can't touch it, so it will stay the way our parliament has decided. Well, it's a little bit more complicated, because nowadays civil rights are, in a way, on a market. To give you an example, if you have a look at small claims, for example, if you buy something from Amazon, something worth 100 euros, and then you're not happy with that, and you start to complain, you won't go to the public court. We heard that earlier. So what will you do? You will try to seek an alternative dispute resolution. You might end up with some payment provider, for example, like PayPal, and ask PayPal for a resolution for your dispute with the trader. So what will PayPal do? They know we have very, 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 very sophisticated and complicated consumer rights in the EU that were enacted throughout the last 10 or 20 years, but they're too complicated for someone from PayPal or from Amazon to deal with it. So what they do is, I asked PayPal what they do, and they say, we have a simple law. So the PayPal law has only one paragraph, one rule, basically, and that says, goods and money can never be at the same place. Which means, if you want to start a complaint about something you got, PayPal will ask you, did you keep the item you bought? If yes, you have the item, you can get a refund of the money. As soon as you send the item back, you'll get your money back. That is the only rule of PayPal law. And that's another example how legal technology and the market for laws doesn't care about what the legislator has said. They have their own simple rules, and those are the ones who kind of determine the way we are acting and trading on marketplaces. How should that influence what we teach at universities? I wouldn't say that our state laws have to change towards something like this PayPal law. That might be too simple. But I think we should keep in mind what amount of our rights are enforceable. And if a right is not enforceable at all, for example, because it's only about small claims and the value is too low that we really ask our public courts to deal with it, then a legislator should keep that in mind. And the same holds true for what we do at universities. We should also teach the law like we taught it before, but we should have in mind the effects of legal technology. There's a colleague of mine from Hamburg who said quite provocatively, include a legal tech into the curriculum of law school. So his name is Daniel Matic, and he said, make it an elective, at least an elective, so a course that you can elect a law school, and let those who are kind of sensible to this topic, let them at least choose to dive deeper and to deal with it already at the university. At the beginning, I was kind of skeptical because I thought legal tech is something that deals with legal practice, and at least in Germany, we now see legal clinics, but basically legal practice is left to the legal traineeship, which is after the first and prior to the second state examination. In the meantime, I was kind of convinced by him, because I think maybe we don't have to teach this topic in 20 years from now, because like for everyone here, it is quite easy to work with a computer. In the beginning of new technology, it might need some further courses or some further occupation with a certain topic so that we can get started. So I think in the end, after having thought about that for a couple of months, maybe he's right. Maybe we should at least tell those students who want to hear about that what legal technology is and what the implications for the future might be. This is also because we have seen quite a wide range of possible professions where a lawyer can end up. So it's not only with a big law firm, it's not only in the administration, it can also be as an entrepreneur. What we see here at a conference like this one, if you go out there and you have a look at the new companies who were coming up in the last couple of years, you see young people who are quite courageous and they tried to break out from the normal way. And many of them were very successful. I know two of them from Munich, Talent Rocket, they built a recruitment company and they're highly successful. And I think as a university, we should also open up our education to such alternative career paths. Not saying that we should leave what we've taught before, but we should teach more of that. And whoever is in legal education right now, I would urge you to come forward with your ideas, to look for optional courses in your legal studies, but also then if you move on to your legal traineeship, because there's at least one stage in your legal traineeship where you can opt for a company, for example, or for some other service provider, where you can have a stage of say 3 months and you can have a look at what they do. And I mean, for me, the traineeship is already done for a couple of years now, but I did it like 10 years ago. I did it with McKinsey. It was a very changing life experience, but if I had to do it again, I would definitely go to one of the legal tech companies and see what they do in order to better understand, because I'm quite convinced that this is the future, and it's good that all of you are here and we are a part of this movement, and let's go on from there. Thank you so much.
Now I'd like to ask you all a question. What is normal? What do you think? Perhaps a better question is, how do we define normal? Normal is one of the easiest words to use in English language, but it is the least able to be defined. It is dependent on standards, on values, on beliefs, on averages. This is the stuff of dreams for lawyers who love to play with words and with ideas like a child plays with Legos. At least they normally do. Mr. Marco Bulaia will now come on stage and tell us how we will redefine a new normal in the IT industry. Mr. Bulaia.
Thank you, Mr. Büchler. The first thing I want to mention is that it's a great pleasure for me to stand here as one of the keynote speakers at the Legal Revolution in Frankfurt. And legal tech is a challenge for the IT industry. Redefining the new normal. That would be my entrance too, and I wanted to explain what's normal. Normal in the IT industry the last 30 years is something that worked for a decade or two decades or more than two decades. And I think it's time to redefine these normal things and these normal processes that we built up for the last 30 years. First time I keep in touch with legal tech, it was in 2013, and I thought, oh god, it's a nice password. Yes, and shortly after that, the Brockner study came out in 2013, and that was called Der Rechtsdienstleistungsmarkt 2030. Yes, that was the first time I think, oh, it should, perhaps it's not a buzzword, it's something that changes the market. Yeah? And the third thing I said, I thought, is legal tech something that we do the last 30 years? And do we get new competitors in this market or something like that? I will go to this point once later on. The next thing I thought is, I read a lot of journalistic articles about legal tech, and I thought, are this the new competitors of the lawyers or of the law firms? And the new enemy, the new platforms that takes away the clients, the consumers from the law firms? And then I thought, okay, there are two kinds of legal tech. Fundamentally, the first part is the, I call it B2C legal tech. Those are the platforms that are focused onto the consumer. And the other thing was the B2B legal tech companies. And I thought that's the one take away the clients, and the other replaces the lawyers. As we are 30 years in the B2B part of legal tech, I realized that it's not enough that we only have a very small part of the legal technology right now, and it's more than writing bills or doing the foreclosure automatically or something like that. Yeah. So I thought, what should we do in the future? And my vision is to combine the B2C and the B2B legal tech technologies to create a win-win situation for the consumer that has new needs that has to be faced with those legal techs, to support the lawyer and not to replace the lawyer with the legal tech technologies, and to create a win-win situation also for the IT industry in the future. So what are the challenges now? The challenges we have to face or we have to solve are, the first one is to automate the process, the business processes in the law firms. That's what we did in parts the last years. The next thing is to automate the legal decisions. Yeah, there are keywords like, for example, artificial intelligence or big data or content we need inside those AI and inside those big data too. The third one is to combine the whole process from the acquisition of the client to the to the writing of the bill, and that's one and all. It's very funny, as I thought that, and I realized the market is changing, and there are new possibilities for all the people who are in contact with this program and with this legal tech party. And so our to-dos are, we have to expand our focus. Expand our focus so that we say, okay, what are the needs of the clients, of the preferred clients of our customers, and what are how do we face them, and how do we support our customers to face the needs of their of their clients in the future. The next thing is that we all have strengths and weaknesses. We should bundle our strengths to create, to prepare this new market. This is a new market, it has to be prepared, and there is no big competition or something like that. Yeah? I said at the beginning of my speech, I said, oh, is the competition getting stronger because DigiTech is more and more society is talking about? No. It's about create and prepare a new market together, and that's why I'm here, and I'm looking forward to two great days with you. Thank you very much.